Good morning. Join us in worshiping this morning.
Where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow.
Right. Good morning. Hey, if you appreciate this band, let them know. Yeah, they do a great job leading us every single week. So, hey, good morning. Want to welcome you. Just say we're glad you're here today. If you're joining us online on our online campus, want to welcome you as well. We're continuing. We're finishing up a series that we started about 3 weeks ago called The Time Is Now. The idea that, you know what, we always have the idea of how we want our life to go. We always want the perfect blueprint to life, but that doesn't always happen. Sometimes, you know, we hit a wall. Sometimes just things don't go the way we thought they should go. And so the time is now to allow allow God to begin to rebuild that in your life. And so we've had an incredible 2 weeks. Pastor Dave will be talking to us today about the blessing of obedience. And so powerful morning. Expect a powerful morning and powerful word from God today. So a couple of announcements I want to make you aware of. Tomorrow night is a serving opportunity with Harmony House. If you'll look in your handout that you received when you came in, from 6 to 8, we'll be meeting at Harmony House, and that is their new location, which is out East Battlefield next to the PFI. From 6 to 8, I'll be helping them kind of begin to move into their facility. There'll be things for every age group to do, so if you've got family and you want to take your kids, there'll be opportunity for them to serve as well, so be a part of that if you can. We'll even provide you a free dinner. Now, how great is that, right? I mean, we want to provide food for you. We just need to know if you're going to be there so we have enough food to order. And so on your way out today, there's a sign up for that on the connection table out in the cafe area. That's tomorrow night, 6 to 8, Harmony House. We could use your help. Also, another sign up thing is our Valentine's banquet. That is February the 11th from 6 to 8. Sign up for that so we kind of, again, know who's going to be here. We need to set up for that. There's all kinds of things that we need to do to prepare for that. Also, during the Valentine's banquet, as we have done the last couple of years, there'll be a dessert auction. And so if you have a wonderful dessert that you always make and you want to bring it that we can auction off, the monies for that go to the youth program. They have a lot of things that they do throughout the year, camps and mission trips and things like that, and that goes to help them and their expenses throughout the year. So last year, I know very well that can be a fun time and raise a lot of money for these kids, because last year I got in a bidding war with Brandon Weldy. Little did I know that he kept signing my name up on things, and I ended up having a lot of desserts to take home last year. So you can even do that if you want, all right? Just put Lance's name down this year instead of mine, right? So no, just Pete, make sure you sign up for that. It'll be a fun time. It always is, and it will be our youth service that evening, and they work hard, and they make that a fun event. So those are a couple of things you need to be aware of that are coming up pretty quick. Go ahead and stand to your feet, if you would, and take an opportunity to meet some people around you.
Thank you.
You stood before creation, eternity in your hands. You spoke the earth into motion, my soul now to stand. You stood before my failures, carried the cross for my shame. My sin weighed upon your shoulders, my soul now to stand. So what could I say? What could I do? But offer this heart, oh God, completely. Thank you. faith will stand. And I will call upon your name. Keep my eyes above the waves. When oceans rise, my soul will rest in your embrace. I am yours. You are mine. Grace abounds in deepest darkness. Sovereign hand, be my guide. Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters wherever you would call me. Take me deeper that my feet could ever wander, and my faith would be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. Spirit, presence of my Savior. Give it leave.
We thank you for all that you bless us with. We praise your name. And I echo the words of that song right now. Spirit, lead us. Spirit, lead us through the service. Guide us by your hand. I pray that you'll guide Dave's words as he brings them to us. Lord God, that you will just show us your light and your love right now. That you will speak to each and every one of our hearts with a clear message. Lord, that I just pray that we'll all be faithful to respond to that. So in Christ's name we pray. Amen. Amen.
You may be seated. And as you do so, thanks, Lance, and thanks to the worship team. And I agree with Pastor John that it's always good when our songs we sing lead us into our time of study of God's Word. And actually, the songs we sung this morning had everything to do with not only the message today, but the message that the series of messages that we've been looking at through the book of Haggai. Was just as I was singing this morning, these songs just calling us to obedience and calling us to surrender. And when we do surrender, that last song, you know, when we do surrender, we find his grace abounds the more. When he calls you to deeper waters, he doesn't abandon us, but his grace meets us and his love meets us. His provision comes around us. And so thanks again, worship team, for reminding us through worship and song of the faithfulness and goodness of God in the midst of obedience. I want to encourage you, if you have a copy of Scripture in front of you electronically or the hard copy, invite you to turn to the book of Haggai. The book of Haggai is an Old Testament book. And if this is the first time you've been with us, we've been going through the series, The Time Is Now. We're just studying out of the book of Haggai. Now, Haggai is a very, very small Old Testament book. And in my Bible, it's because of the font size, it's 2 pages long. Covers pages 888 through 890, I believe it is. And so it's a very powerful book, though it's a very small book. Pastor Mike, several weeks ago, mentioned that it's often referred to as a minor prophet. And the minor prophets were no different than the major prophets outside of this. The scope of their ministry and the scope of their message was a lot smaller footprint than those that we consider major prophets, like Isaiah and Jeremiah and Daniel, where their ministry sometimes lasted decades or over the course of several years. There's other times that God would raise up other prophets where their ministry was just in a very short window of time and opportunity. And this is where we find the book of Haggai and the prophet named Haggai. His ministry is probably one of the shortest prophet ministries on record. His entire scope of his ministry lasted approximately 3 to 4 months. 3 months of ministry and 1 month of silence. We'll just give him that extra month and call it 4 months just for show. But listen, this man, though he was a minor prophet in the duration of his ministry, the prophetic message that God gave this man was life-changing, not only to those people of Haggai's day, but also very much reticent to us today as we are trying to be men and women who seek after God in obedience. And so the prophet Haggai's ministry, like I said, it was small in scope, but this is what God had raised him up to do. He raised Haggai up to tell his people to get to the work that he had called them to do. To get over the discouragement, as Pastor Tony shared with us last week, and build the temple. He had called them 15 years prior to Haggai coming on the scene to go back to Jerusalem where the people had been cast out in exile. The temple had been destroyed. And God said, I want you to go back to Jerusalem and rebuild not only the walls of Jerusalem, but also my temple. And so they all came back to Jerusalem. A certain amount of the Jewish remnant came back to Jerusalem, and they began to rebuild the wall. And we see in the book of Ezra, Haggai is mentioned as one of the prophets that God raised up during that time of rebuilding in order to encourage the people to be obedient to what God had called them to do. So we know that through other books that Haggai fits perfectly within the scenario of what's going on in the history of Israel at the time. We don't know much about Haggai. There's only one brief mention in the second chapter of Haggai that gives any scope of how old this man was. It says in chapter 2 that he was around when the temple was originally there, which means that, 70 years ago, that's when the temple the former temple was built. And so he knew of that. So more than likely, God called this man out of retirement in his older age to be the messenger of God. And I can only say this, he had to be a faithful man of God throughout of all of his life for God to raise him up in his latter days to bring this important message to his people. His ministry is so short that he gave four messages, four sermons, I guess you can say. Isn't that wonderful? His ministry was only one more week longer than what we're giving him, through this series. But he had four messages, right? The first two messages came in 1 month. Then there was a rest period. And then the last two messages came upon each other in the third month or the fourth month. And his ministry is so short that the Bible even gives us the date of his third sermon. The date of his third sermon is December the 11th, 580 B.C., And I want to say this. This is the beautiful part about God's word and about the book of Haggai, is that even though that there are centuries that have gone by from Haggai's day to our day, there still remains this whole thing of issue of God's people obeying God fully. And that is what is at stake here. And so let's read this morning this third sermon from Haggai to God's people. And what I've done is sometimes Old Testament books can be kind of hard to delve into, especially when there's some words of prophecy or some words that we don't usually use today in our vernacular. And so I've done something differently. I usually teach out of the New American Standard Version, but I found in my study of this passage that the Message translation helps us kind of get our arms around some of the complicated wording here in Haggai. So I'm using the Message translation, and probably most of you don't have that translation, so we'll provide that for you on the screen as you follow along. Well, on December 11th, 580 BC, again, this was in the second year of Darius, God's message came to Haggai, God of the angel armies speak, consult the priests for a ruling. If someone carries a piece of sacred meat in his pocket, meat that is set apart for sacrifice on the altar, and the pocket touches a loaf of bread, a dish of stew, a bottle of wine or oil, or any other food, will these foods be made holy by such contact? And all the priests together said no. Then Haggai said, how about someone who is contaminated by touching a corpse? If that person touches one of these foods, will it be contaminated? And again, all the priests again agreed and said, yes, it will be contaminated. Then Haggai said, so this people is contaminated, their nation is contaminated, everything they do is contaminated, whatever they do for me is contaminated, God said so. I think God's trying to get a point across there, right? Think back in verse 15, think back, before you set out to lay the first foundation stones for the rebuilding of my temple, how did it go with you? Isn't it true that your foot dragging and half-hearted efforts at rebuilding the temple of God were reflected in a sluggish, half-hearted return on your crops, half the grain you were used to getting, half the wine? I hit you with drought and blight and hail. Everything you were doing got hit, but it didn't seem to faze you. You continued to ignore me, God's decree. Now think ahead of that from the same date, December 11th, 580 BC. Think ahead from when the temple rebuilding was launched. Has anything in your fields, vine, fig tree, pomegranate, olive oils, failed to flourish? From now on, from this day forward, you can count on a blessing. I think I mentioned this on several occasions from the platform, but sometimes I just don't like holiday gatherings. The Myers family, we just don't do holidays well together. You know, we like to celebrate holidays wonderfully on our own, but you get us in the same room and things just go bad really quickly. And so usually, most times out of not, you know, Easter and Christmas time, Thanksgiving time, you know, I make my way up to Kansas City and not knowing what I'm about to face, you know, with the family. There's always someone mad at someone. There's always a feud going on in the family. I'm sure you guys don't even have a clue what I'm talking about in your families, right? But there's always a feud going on. Someone will say something to somebody else at the mealtime, and that gets everybody all riled up. I mean, before you know it, you got half the people on one side, the other people, other half on the other side. We just, you know, for whatever reason, we just seem can't get our act together when we're in the same room at holidays. But this Christmas, it was so different. I felt like I was living in a twilight zone for a while because my family was getting along. I was like, holy cow, it's Christmas Eve, and it's kumbaya, and it's a wonderful feeling. And Christmas morning, it was still there. Christmas lunch, you know, the next day, and Christmas dinner, it was still there. The day after Christmas, oh my goodness, there was peace and harmony in the Myers clan, and loved every moment of it, loved every moment of it. But one of the things that was so different this year, and maybe this had something to do with it, I'm not sure, but this year we celebrated the 15th anniversary of my Grandpa Freeman's passing. He passed away during the holiday season 15 years ago. And I'm sure you have someone like a Grandpa Freeman in your family. He was the bedrock, you know, for several generations. He was the glue that kind of held our family together. He was the peacemaker. He was the guy who you went to for all your problems to be solved and all that good stuff. And so, you know, 15 years has passed by, and for my grandpa, you know, his death still kind of looms heavy on our family. But this year, someone ran into a back bedroom at my grandmother's house and pulled out a photo album, and we began going down the memory lane. You know, all the kids were off doing their toy thing and, you know, playing on computers, and all the adults kind of gathered around, and we started telling stories about our reminiscing about our Grandpa Freeman. And one of the things that we all kind of came to the conclusion was we have this favorite memory, all of us do, which is a weird memory to have. All the aunts and uncles, all the cousins, all the grandkids, we all remember one thing about my Grandpa Freeman. He had a belt that hung on a loop, or whatever you call it, a hook, in the living room of the house, right by his coat closet. Now, remember, this is 1970s, 1980s. I know we disciplined kids a lot better and with a lot more grace than we did back then. I don't know how in the world we survived those decades, but we did. So please, no judgment on this. But so he had this long strap on the wall, right? And we remember our grandpa. I mean, he's one of those guys who was 6'4", you know, just tall, strapping guy, and he always had a plug of tobacco in his mouth, you know, and so there's something about him. He's just almost like a John Wayne figure, you know, walk in the room, and you're like, uh-oh, you know, trouble's about to happen. But if you were getting in trouble by him, all he had to do was look at you. You have anyone in your family like that? Maybe a grandpa or a grandmother, an old uncle. I mean, there's something about walking into the room and just staring at you, not saying anything, and your heart just melts. Or if you was pushed to it, he would come up to you and he would kind of rebuke you and just kind of correct you at times. But he'd always threaten us, don't make me go get that belt off the wall, right? And one of the things that we all came to conclusion, all the grandkids, all aunts and uncles, all the cousins, was that in all the years of my grandpa's life, he never once got that belt off the hook. No one ever got the belt, right, as a form of discipline. We didn't need to be honest with you, because, again, I mean, his word, I mean, kind of set us straight. And so this is what's kind of going on in the book of Haggai. God says, don't make me use this belt. And there's times that God is forced to use that hand of discipline, and that hand of discipline is a hard hand. But just like my grandpa always wanted to demonstrate grace and love to his grandkids and to his children, our God is a God who wants to demonstrate tremendous mercy and tremendous grace. And though there's times in our lives where, because of our continual disobedience, he has to reach out for a belt, for the most part, he doesn't want to use the belt. He wants to convince us. He wants to be long-suffering towards us, so that through that long-suffering grace and that long-suffering mercy towards us, that we might be, have an awakening and get back to work. Well, in the days of Haggai, the words of God were falling on deaf ears. And so 15 years had passed by, and they were still kind of half-heartedly going about rebuilding the temple of God. And so God said, okay, I've got to get the belt. And what he did was he brought a drought upon the land in order to get their attention. But as we just read today out of Haggai, the drought meant nothing to these people. They still were not obeying God. They were still not turning their hearts back to God. And in fact, they were just living in the misery, and they were okay with the misery that God had brought on. And God was like, this is not what I want from you. I'm not bringing you discipline in order to keep you miserable. I'm bringing discipline in order to woo you back to me. But if that's not going to do it for you, let me go back to words of encouragement. Let me go back to sending a man into your midst, an old man to your midst, to say, thus saith the Lord, get on with it. The time is now. Get to work. Overcoming your distractions. I have much, much more for you than you know about. And this is what today's message is all about. The message is this: there is more that God has for you and I at the end of our obedience. There's something that God has for you when you choose to believe him, when you choose to trust him, when he's calling you to do something that maybe you're unfamiliar with, and you get kind of wobbly in the knees thinking that God's calling you to do something that is far larger than you can ever begin imagining God using you for. But yet God sees and God knows what's at the end of your obedience, and you can't see it yourself. There are times that God's calling us to be men and women who restores things in life. And we have no idea what waits at the end of a restored relationship, a restored marriage. But God surely does. And he calls us to obedience. Sometimes there's something in our society that God's calling you to. God's calling you to bring justice to through obedience. And he knows what's at stake in your obedience. And he knows what people will go without through your constant disobedience. And so this is what's going on in this time with Haggai. And the same thing kind of translates to us today. You know, that there is a moment of blessing that God wants to give to us through obedience. Now, this is one thing I want to make very, very well known to. This message is going to hit on two things. This message is going to hit on the all grace, 100% grace all the time faction and teaching. And it's also going to hit on, you know, the works mentality part of teaching. And I hope that you know me by now that I would never stand on this platform and I would never speak to you about a gospel that is saturated with works. You know, there's no such thing as a health and wealth gospel that sometimes is kind of proclaimed in our land today. This is not what God's getting at in Haggai, and this is not what I'm about to share with you today. It's not about health and wealth. It's not about you God scratching your back and you say, God, I'll scratch your back in return. It has nothing to do with that. Here's what it comes down to. It comes down to obedience always leads to God's blessing. Let me repeat that one more time. Your obedience will always lead to God's blessing. And here's where the warning comes across. Blessings don't always mean material possessions. Yes, there are times that you pray for things, that you ask God for certain things, and God does give it to you. But listen, having material things does not mean that God is blessing you. All right? What he's more concerned about is your heart. What he's more concerned about is your relationship with him. And again, what he's more concerned about, because it's repeated over and over again in this passage, is our obedience. And what I'm saying to you is that blessings of God and blessings of your obedience comes in many forms. It's about the restoration in relationships because you choose to forgive somebody else. It's about the quality of your marriage, that you're willing to obey God's biblical principles about your role in marriage, that you begin to see your marriage go to that next level. It's about assisting someone you know who is a prodigal, returning back to the Lord. It's about you being used of God, like I said before, you being used of God to spearhead the justice of God in the midst of a lot of injustice in our society, in our world. It's about, you know, being presented to Christ as someone who says, I want to live my life for your glory and for your renown. God, I want to know and I want to experience and I want to live out what is your known will for my life. You see, at the end of all of that is where the blessings of obedience lie in. It's about a life of authentic worship. It's about a life in which the gospel impacts your life so much so that you want to take that same gospel and tell other people about. You see, the probably the best thing about the blessings of obedience is this, is that when we obey God to the full, and we're going to get to that in a few moments, then what we receive is his presence. What we receive is his assurance, his empowerment, and the fulfillment that comes in life when he chooses you to be a minister of grace in some form or fashion in your relationships and in this church and in the world around us. It comes out of a heart that says, God, I'm going to seek you with all my heart. Your kingdom first. Your righteousness first, God. That is what my heart is all about. And if this sounds anything interesting to you, whether you're a teenager here this morning or you're 70 years old, if this sounds interesting to you, I'm going to say this, that there is an opportunity for you to know and experience the blessings of God through your complete and utter obedience. This past couple weeks, I've been in a book, and it's been kind of a heavy book. It's about, the book's called In the Eyes of Suffering, and it talks about men and women throughout the church history that have taken up a lot of abuse and a lot of suffering for the sake of the gospel. And there was a guy by the name of John Bunyan, and John Bunyan wrote Pilgrim's Progress, which is probably one of the greatest Christian literature out there. And he lived in the 1600s. In the 1600s, England, it was against the law to preach the gospel. But John Bunyan had this calling upon his life, and he couldn't shake it, and so he began to preach the gospel. Well, that ended up him being put in jail. Now, the officials of the day said, listen, if you would just sign this document, Mr. Bunyan, that says, I will no longer preach the gospel, we'll let you out, and we won't think anything about it. We'll just let you out and let you go about your life, but you got to stop preaching the gospel. Well, he refused to do it. Well, 1 year turned into 2 years, 2 years turned into 5 years, 5 years turned into 10 years, 10 years turned into 12 years, and here this man was in prison all this time. So what the authorities would do is they would bring in his youngest daughter. His youngest daughter was blind. And because John Bunyan had spent all this time in jail, his family financially, you know, was experiencing hardship, and they needed the father at home. And so they bring the blind daughter into his jail cell, and they would say, listen, your daughter's suffering here. Your daughter needs her dad back at the house. Just sign right here. Just sign right here and stop proclaiming the gospel. And John Bunyan said it was the most wretching experience of his life. He did not want to see the day. Every weekday, you know, Fridays, I think it was, every Fridays, they bring the daughter in. And he just didn't look forward to that moment because it just broke his heart. But he realized something here about this. He believed that if God had called him to suffer because of a stand he was taking and because he was being completely obedient to God, then God would take care of his family. God would take care of his blind daughter. And that's exactly what God did for that family. And so he said, you know what? I'm willing to step out in faith and trust that God, that in the end of my obedience, God will take care of not only my needs, but my family's needs as well. And that is what's at stake. This ability for you to be obedient to God at any time and in any measure and respond positively to what he's saying in his word, the commands he gives us in the scripture, or through the voice of the Holy Spirit when he calls you to do something. One of the things that stands in the way of us truly understanding and experiencing the blessings of obedience kind of comes down to bad theology. We kind of, you know, there was someone had come up with, John Calvin, I believe it was, came up with the fact that our hearts are nothing more than idol-making factories. And sometimes, you know, our idols-making factories in our heart kind of wants to water down the impact and the truthfulness of God's word, to the point that sometimes because of our disobedience, we want to skew God's word and we end up having bad theology. And so this is what I want to kind of counteract, and this is what Haggai's message in chapter 2 is all about. He's trying to counteract the bad theology that people in Haggai's day, and in fact, we also struggle with this today. 2,500 years later, we struggle with what it means to be completely obedient to God. So let me just kind of walk you through the two misconceptions of obedience that Haggai brings out in this message. And let's go back and read verses chapter 15 through 17, because the first misconception is that God is okay with our half-hearted devotion. What does he say? Think back before you set out to lay the first foundation stones for the building of my temple. How did it go for you? In other words, God says, 15 years has passed. You know, when I called you to the temple to rebuild it, how have things been going for the past 15 years? Isn't it true that your foot-dragging, half-hearted efforts at rebuilding the temple of God were reflected in a sluggish, halfway return on your crops, half the grain you were used to getting, half the wine? I hit you with drought. I hit you with blight. I hit you. In other words, God's saying, I just threw everything at you, right? And everything you were doing got hit, but it didn't seem to faze you. You continued to ignore me. I've heard the statement before, maybe you have too, that 99% obedience is still disobedience. When God calls you to obey, you oftentimes fail to do so because you try to find a way out of the situation. You try to find those loopholes. This past week, I was doing a memorandum of understanding between the organization I work for and an organization that wants to come alongside of us to help us. And so my role was to look through the contract and find out if there was any loopholes. Was there any way that the other entity was going to have, you know, a more favor or have better things out of this memorandum of understanding than we would receive? And so I'm going through with a fine-tooth comb trying to figure out, is there an aha moment? Is there a way out that they can do something without us being benefited for it? And sometimes when we come to obedience, that's what we're looking for. We're afraid of what it really means to fully commit to something. We're really afraid to fully surrender because we are creatures of habit. We're creatures of control. We kind of want to have our say in the table as saying when God calls to do something, we'll say, yes, God, we'll do that. However, can we do it this way? Can we do it in this timing? Can we do it according to my plans? And God's saying, no, none of that. I'm calling you to obedience, and your response to me should be, yes, Lord, and only yes, Lord. What I find interesting in verses 15 through 17 is that according to God, who comes out the loser in this battle of obedience? Does God come out as a loser? Absolutely not. Who comes out as a loser? It's the people of God who only half-heartedly do what he calls them to do. Look what he says. You get half return for your crops. You get half the grain you're used to getting and half the wine. In other words, God is saying, listen, because you only did things on a half-hearted basis, I cut back the blessing halfway. You were only getting half of what your crops could have gotten. You were only bringing in enough wine, half of the wine that you should have been receiving. And this is what I think what C.S. Lewis, he is a famous apologist of the Christian faith, he said this famous quote one time, and this is what he says. He says, it would seem that our Lord finds our desires not too strong but too weak. We are half-hearted creatures fooling about with drink and sex and ambition when infinite joy is offered us, like an ignorant child who wants to go on making mud pies in a slum because he cannot imagine what is meant by the offer of a holiday by the sea. We are far too easily pleased. And that brings up the question, doesn't it? When you and I settle for half-hearted obedience, what are we giving up? What are we missing out on? What are we too afraid or unwilling to say, yes, Lord? Is there a relationship that can be restored if you just simply said, yes, Lord? Could your marriage or your finances be sorted out if you're willing to say, yes, Lord? Can there be someone in this community that today is living in poverty or living in alone or living in great need that if God would just use you and you said yes to the Lord, that need can be met? Is there some way that Northbridge Church can become a stronger church through your service and and through your actions or through your willingness to take the gospel message to our community, to the world, if you would just say, yes, Lord. I believe that there's a lot that's out there for us and for you. If you wholeheartedly say, God, I will step out and I will trust you. I was meeting with several people in between services today, and they were just even sharing with me what God was doing in their life. And one guy said, you know what? God's been showing me over and over and over again what I have to do, but I've been kind of, you know, doing what the people in Haggai's people today did. He's been so unsure and so not confident that God can do what he's called him to do. And so he's been sluggish in saying yes to God. But he also believes that because of that, there are people missing out on ministry opportunity because he's waiting so long to be obedient to God's commands. So what is it in your life that you've settled halfway for? I think we're so prone that we're willing to just get the dribbles of God's grace, of God's love, of God's mercy. We're willing just to get the little droplets of God's provision in our lives instead of just standing under the waterfall of what he wants to shower us with when we're just completely, completely surrendered to him in all things. He wants to lavish things upon us. And that's what Haggai was getting at. Haggai was saying, I'm not punishing you to take things from you. I just want you to wake up because I want to give you much, much more than what you can perceive. And sometimes we're, like C.S. Lewis said, we just willing to live in the slum, playing with mud pies in the street, instead of enjoying the lavishness of God's love and what God brings us, the infinite joy that he wants to offer us. So misconception number one is that God is okay with our half-hearted obedience. The answer is no, he is not. He's only satisfied with our complete obedience. Number two, the second misconception is that serving God makes you right with God. Serving God makes you right with God. And because of the lack of time, I just want to, Brenda, if she can put it on the screen, verses 10 through 12. We don't have time to reread these words on the screen, but kind of let me just kind of walk you through what's going on. So God says, hey, Haggai, go to the priests at the temple and ask them two questions. Ask them, number one, does the meat that they carry around in the robes, if that piece of meat that's hidden in that robe, and that robe touched another object on the way to the altar, does that object become holy because the piece of meat is holy? And all the priests said, absolutely not. And he goes, okay, if you touch someone, a dead body, you know, does that defile something else or someone else you touch? And they said, absolutely yes. And what God's getting at is this, is that in Haggai's time, when the priests were also not only serving people at the altar, but they were also the butchers of the day. So if I came in with my calf and I wanted to offer that calf as a sacrifice to God, what the priests would do, they would take it, and the moment I offered it up as a sacrifice to God, it became holy. And when they would butcher it up, that calf up, and maybe they had to take certain pieces and put it on the altar, from where I handed off the calf to the priest to where the altar was a far bit. And so what they do is they take up chunks of meat and they'd put it in the pockets of their apron and they would walk over to the altar and put the sacrifice on the altar. And so what he's getting at is that the things that we do for God, does that make us holy? And the answer is no. Why? Because we have a corruptible heart. We have a corruptible sin nature. And our sin nature, we can never make up for our sin nature and works for God. Our sin nature can only be overcome through the grace and the work of God in our lives. That's what he's getting at. Let me put in a modern day illustration. Suppose today for lunch after church, I'm going to go home, I'm going to make me some meatloaf, right? And so what do I do? I go, and the first thing I do is I wash my hands at the sink, and then I go to the bowl, and I put the meat in the bowl, and I put the eggs in the bowl, I put the breadcrumbs in the bowl, I squirt some ketchup or some tomato sauce in the bowl, and I just, you know, just go to town. Isn't there something better than squishing hamburger meat in a bowl with eggs? Oh, my goodness. And before you know it, I mean, I'm patting it down, and I'm spreading it out, and I'm shaping it into the loaf, to the meatloaf loaf that it needs to be. And before you know what happens, my clean hands are now covered in the gunk, right? You see, my clean hands, when I went to go work with the meatloaf, my clean hands did not transfer to the meatloaf. It was the meatloaf that transferred to my hand. That's what God's getting at. Same principle involves with people who are sick. You know, how do we get communicable diseases? Because someone sneezes in your vicinity and spews those particles of disgusting filth your way, or someone wipes their nose and shakes your hand at church, you know, or picks their nose and shakes your hand at church. And then, I mean, that's how we get sick, right? But if I come around you as a healthy individual, I just, in your presence, I just breathe on you, my health is not going to be transferred to your to make you healthy, but your sickness can make me sick. So the principle is this, is that there's nothing you can do for God that allows you to be holy. We work for God, we labor for God, because we love God. That's why we do. That's why we're obedient. We're obedient because we love Him and we want to make much of Him in our lives. And so for us today, listen, for us today is in the works-related mentality sometimes we have is that just because we're working for God, God doesn't look the other way when it comes to our sin. And God doesn't say you're forgiven if you put in X amount of hours in the service in my kingdom. And for those who are outside of the faith of Christianity, you cannot work your way to heaven. That's what God's getting at. What God is saying is that there must be something more that takes place in our hearts. And that for us is the grace of Jesus Christ. You see, our faith is bound in the life and the death and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And through that faith, that's what makes us clean. It's Christ Himself who makes us clean, not our works. So the bad theology that people in Haggai's day believed was that God was okay with their sin just as long as they continue to serve Him, and absolutely not. This is what Jesus railed about in the gospel accounts. In His ministry on the earth, He was always after the Pharisees. And there's a particular passage in Matthew chapter 23 where He just lays it all out for them. Because remember, the Pharisees of the day, listen, they weren't bad people. They were just caught up in works, right? They were caught up in religion. They were caught up in saying, I'm a good man, and because I'm a good man, I do good things for God. God and I were okay with one another. And this is what Jesus says, this sweet little Jesus that we say is wonderful and compassionate. This is what He says, you're hopeless, you religious scholars and Pharisees, frauds. You burnish the surface of your cups and bowls so they sparkle in the sun, while the insides are maggoty with your greed and gluttony. Stupid Pharisees, scour the insides, and then the gleaming surface will mean something. You're hopeless, you religious scholars and Pharisees. Frauds, you're like manicured grave plots, grass clipped and the flowers bright, but 6 feet down, it's all rotting bones and worm-eating flesh. People look at you and think you're saints, but beneath the skin, you're total frauds. Wow. From the gospel account of Matthew, right? Jesus was saying, listen, you can walk around and you can be pious all you want. God is not concerned about your outward acts as much as He's concerned about your heart. And for us, we're no different sometimes. God's saying, you know what? You go around, you want to do things for me, and you want to do great things for my kingdom, but you haven't had a heart change. That you're content with sin in your life. You're content with things in your life that hold you back. Some of us really today are just stuck, right? We're just stuck in our faith. We're stuck in life situations. We're stuck by certain circumstances that sin brings on our life. And God's saying, enough is enough. Work on the inside and serve me, right? Or serve me because you love me, not because your righteousness will make you whole through your works. Our right standing with God does not come from anything we can do with our hands. It comes through the grace of Jesus Christ alone. And that's what Isaiah chapter 64, 6 says. All of our righteous acts are like filthy garments in the presence of a holy God. So if our acts towards God does nothing for us, what is God after? And this is where the crux of Haggai's ministry has been all about. God is after your heart. God is after your heart. God wants your heart. God wants your full devotion. God wants your full worship. God wants your full adoration. God wants everything. He wants to be first in your life, not last. He wants to be the first fruit of your life, not the scraps that you give him at the end. This is how Haggai ends his message. He says, from December 11th, 580 on, from this day forward, I am going to choose to bless you. I'm going to bless you. Now, this is what I think is very interesting about this passage. He's not saying you got to get yourself right first. He's just saying, if you would just take these steps of obedience to me, you can guarantee obedience will lead to blessing. Obedience will lead to blessing. So for you and I, what is that step that you have to take for blessing in your life? What's that step that you have to take? And sometimes you got to risk it all. Sometimes you have to let go of everything that you know you've known to be comfortable. Hey, listen, I'm going through a time in my life right now where it's kind of, personally, it's kind of painful. I'm at a place that I have to make some decisions about my future and what God is up to in my life. And this has been preaching to me for several weeks now as I've been studying Haggai, because God's telling Dave Myers this. He's telling me this. He's saying, are you willing to trust me in the unknown? Are you willing to trust me when you can't see me at work in your life? David, can you trust that I have a provision for you in your future? And sometimes for us to answer those questions, folks, it's a struggle in the heart, isn't it? I mean, it's not easy at all. I mean, it's tough to say, Lord, I give to you, because like I said before, we're just creatures that like to hold on to things. We're creatures who want a voice at the, you know, a seat at the table and a voice in the conversation with God. And God's saying, no. I'll handle it all for you. I know your future. I know what's out there. I know what's in store for you. You just have to decide, are you willing to obey and trust me? Or are you willing just to continue to live in the slum of spiritual mediocrity, making mud pies? Or are you willing to go to that next level of faith and experience all of my favor, all of my blessings that I have waiting for you, if only you will trust in me? And so God says this: if you've been half-hearted in your obedience to God in any of your life, in any area, large or small, God says, if you will just repent, you will find my blessings at the end of that repentance. If you've been serving God with wrong motives, God says, just repent, and I will bless you. If you've been living a sparkling life on the outside, but you are maggot-infested on the inside, God says, if you will repent, I will bless you. If you live like a saint on the outside, but inside you know you are a fraud, God says, especially to you, repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand, and I will bless you. In closing, obedience always leads to God's blessing, because there can be no better blessing than to know the living God and to live in his presence and to experience his moving in your life and to be able to walk confidently in the assurance that he has got you when you think your life is falling apart. Would you pray with me? Father, thank you, Lord, for the message out of Haggai this morning. And thank you, Lord, for showing us that you are a God of tremendous grace. Thank you, Lord, for your love, for your kindness, for your compassion towards us. Because sometimes, Father, we just mess things up in our lives. Lord, sometimes it's so scary, Lord, when you call us to do something and it's overwhelming to us. The call is too great. The sacrifice is too much. Sometimes the suffering is unbelievable. But, Lord, if we could just trust in you for all things, and trust that your word is true, that in the end of every act of obedience is your blessing, in the end, Lord, it's all worth it. And Father, today I pray that as people here that's in this room today or visiting with us on the iCampus, that Father, whatever the story may be, whatever the circumstance may be, that you're calling individuals to complete obedience. Father, help us in our repentance. And help us to trust in you and to surrender all things to you so that in the end we might make much of you and be blessed by you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. If you stand to your feet and sing this last song, and this song goes so powerfully with what we just studied in God's Word about surrendering everything to God.
Take my life, I lay it down at the cross where I am found. All I have I give to you, O God. Take my hands and make them clean. Keep my heart in purity, that I may walk in all you have for me. Oh,
stand arms open wide.
Good. It was a powerful morning. I hope that those words that we just sang was your response. Those words were a declaration of our desire to be obedient to God. And I hope that that you have been challenged today. Pastor Dave, thank you. Incredible insight on that. The time is now. It's been an incredible series. Last 3 weeks has been an incredible 3 weeks. And so I encourage you, if you missed a week or you want to go back and look at a week, you can go to our website. And all of those weeks are posted on our website there. So hope you've been challenged today. Next Sunday is a special time. It's a special Sunday that we don't typically do. It's called Good News Sunday. And so we're going to have a guest speaker. We don't do that a lot, but we are going to have a guest speaker. Sarah Forhetz from KY3 will be here. She'll be sharing her story. She will be sharing the gospel. And so I encourage you to invite friends, invite people that maybe need to hear a clear word of God to come and be a part of next Sunday. And so really, it'll be a fun time, and encourage you to be here. So don't forget about our serving project tomorrow night, 6 to 8, Harmony House. Please sign up for that so we know how much food to order. And again, don't forget about our Valentine's banquet coming up. Have a great day.